Hello, all my beautiful sisters from those other misters. Welcome back to my channel. Today I'm doing my April beauty recap. This is a series where I talk about things that have been prominent in my beauty life in the previous month. Not necessarily favorites and fails, although often there are favorites and fails involved with these videos, but also things that are just things that are prominent in my life, and sometimes I'm still kind of on the fence about them. Occasionally I talk about non-beauty related things, and that's actually something that I want to start with today. So in my last recap, I talked about a bunch of Game of Thrones whiskies that I had purchased. They were collaborative whiskies from Scottish whiskey distilleries, and each one had taken one of their particular types of whiskey that they create, and they had themed it around Game of Thrones. And I said in that video I was missing two bottles. I was missing House Tyrell, which didn't launch in Australia at all because of licensing rights. We've got one in Australia that is called Tyrell Wine, so we understand, or I understand, why we didn't get the House Tyrell whiskey here. The other one that I couldn't get was actually House Baratheon, and that did launch in Australia, but for some reason it seemed to be the hardest to find of all of them. Everywhere I looked, they were sold out. They were sold out online. I went to every single bottle shop that I passed by in the space of a month. I went into, there were so many times when I was like driving just randomly wherever I was going, and I'd see a bottle shop and I'm like, oh my god, I need to go in there. So I'd find a park and I'd like run back to the shop and have a look. Now, I never found it. The closest I came, I was actually with Kat, and we went into a bottle shop and we were talking to a guy, and he's like, oh, I think I do have that one. And he actually like sort of looked through a box and I saw the label and I was like, that's it, I want it. And he's like, it's an order for someone else. And I tried to convince him to sell it to me. He wouldn't do it. So he's doing the right thing. But I just couldn't get it. I couldn't get House Baratheon for the life of me. And when I did my last recap, I had quite a few people suggest some places where I might be able to purchase the bottles online, and I followed them all up. Unfortunately, none of them panned out, but I actually bought them at auction. So I bought them from a British auction house that runs worldwide. You can bid online, and they are on their way to me as I speak, so that's really exciting. I'll show you guys those bottles when they come in the next recap. So I finished my collection, hopefully. My god, knowing my luck, I feel like the world has been a little bit against me recently. I've had a few, not like massive things, but like just little things happening that are like really like annoying. So I'm scared that these bottles are gonna arrive broken. I'm just, please, please, please don't let that happen. So yeah, fingers crossed that all goes to plan. Since we're talking about Game of Thrones, I figure I should talk about the Game of Thrones Urban Decay collection. So this collection launched in April. I found this vault. The vault did not technically launch in Australia. The retailer in Australia for Urban Decay is Mecca, and they didn't launch the vault here. They only launched the individual products. Now, before it launched in Mecca, I was on Selfridges and I spotted the vault along with some of the other collection. They had everything except for the two individual brushes. And the brushes were like the one thing that I knew without a shadow of a doubt I wanted to own. So I decided that I may as well buy the vault. In terms of how much the individual items were going to cost, comparing it, like if I was to buy them in Australia and then comparing it to purchasing the vault off Selfridges and taking into consideration that I had a Selfridges Plus membership, it meant I got free shipping and I was getting a fairly good deal in comparison to what I would pay for this all individually in Australia. So I bought the vault. There she is. I'm not gonna hold this up again because it's kind of bulky and annoying. So I did like Kat and I did a swatch video of this on Beauty News, and a lot of it swatched really nicely. Then I did like just doing my makeup reviewing this collection, and I felt like in the grand scheme of things, it wasn't really super impressive. The eyeshadow quality is nice. The eyelining pencils are really nice, but that's kind of where it ended for me. The brushes are really cute, but I haven't used them. I'll never use them. I purchased them for the sake of keeping them as like a display piece. So I don't really like, I don't know. I kind of find it difficult to make any statements about their quality. Other than the quality control, one of Kat's brushes was really jacked up. The bristles were all bent and splayed, and it was the same with my little needle brush. I had to like wet it and put it in a brush guard, which was really fucking difficult because it's got this like little hilt part with the sword. So that was pretty disappointing, but I won't use the brushes, so I can't really like comment on how good they are, but they're just like all of Urban Decay's eyeshadow brushes. Like if you have ever purchased an Urban Decay Naked palette, like from any of the Naked series, and it came with a double-ended brush, that's what you've got. That's exactly what these brushes are, except they've got these cool little hilts. The palette, the highlighting palette. Ugh, I hated it. The lip and cheek stain, not a product I would use, so it, you know, it's a bit irrelevant to me. And the lipsticks I found to be really disappointing. The Sansa Stark one, it like clung to dry patches on my lips. And then I also wore the Night King shade and that clung to dry patches, but it looked a bit better. So yeah, I was pretty underwhelmed with the collection. I definitely think Urban Decay could have done it better, but I'm super glad like a property like fucking Sephora didn't get their hands on it, because then it would have been like all of this Avengers Endgame crap that we're seeing, and it like that would have been a fucking tragedy. So could have been worse, but it sure as fuck could have been better as well. So after purchasing this, it eventually launched in Australia at Mecca. It only launched online, so it wasn't available in store. And I didn't worry too much about the launch day because I already had the vault. I wasn't intending on buying anything as a backup or anything like that. I know I will never use a single item in here enough for it to be like that product is empty and now I'm missing something from my collection. But what happened on launch day was, I think I woke up at like, I don't know, maybe 9 o'clock, and everything was sold out. There wasn't a single thing left on the Mecca website. There wasn't even a sign on the website that it had even been there. And throughout the day, I was seeing a lot of comments from people who were like, I was on there at like 7 a.m. I had my cart full, and by 7:10, I only managed to check out with two of the items that I wanted. So Mecca must have had like such a tiny, tiny amount of products. I wouldn't have got any of it. I would have missed out completely and I would have been fucking furious. So I'm glad that I've got the vault. I'm glad that I just purchased it. Next item, Super Sponge. So this is a new to market makeup sponge. And essentially what you have is your traditional teardrop makeup sponge. And then like the majority of the sponge, so hopefully you'll be able to see, there's like a pale part down the bottom and a slightly darker part up the top. All of this darker part is infused with silicone. So it's like the outer layer of the sponge has a really thin silicone coating. And the idea of this sponge is that it doesn't absorb as much foundation, it just spreads it over your face better. So you're using less product. Now, I did like a comparison to a Real Techniques Miracle Complexion sponge with this. I really like this little sponge. I like this so much that I'm still considering buying one while they're on pre-sale so I have a backup, but I'm trying to not be that person anymore. So I'm not going to do it. I'm going to chill. I'm going to use my sponge, and then when I need a replacement, I will purchase a replacement like a sane person. But what I particularly love about this sponge is that it has created a new application technique for me. So in the past, I would typically use two different methods of applying my foundation and concealer based on my skin condition at that particular time and the finish that I'm going for, and sometimes the like texture of my foundation. So if I am going for a light coverage, a natural coverage, say I am just going out with friends or I'm running errands for the day and I want to wear makeup, or even if I'm just hanging around the house but I want to play with makeup on a particular day, usually I just use a sponge. I just use like either the Miracle Complexion sponge or the Ella Cosmetics sponge, and I just put my foundation on that way. I don't typically build it up so it's got like a heavier layer. I just put on one layer, whether it be light or medium coverage, and then I finish the rest of my makeup. If I'm going for a more full coverage, I typically reach for a brush. When I'm reaching for a brush, I typically go for something like one of these. The reason I would use these over like a sponge for a heavier application is that it applies more product to your face in a quicker time than dabbing on with a sponge would. Now, if my skin is like peeling from the retinol uglies, or I'm just having a bad skin day and I want full coverage, but it's not working with a brush, like it might be lifting peeling skin, or I can't get around dry patches without it clinging, then I'm gonna go in with a sponge and I'm gonna slowly build up those layers. Sometimes I will also choose a sponge over a brush no matter what, if the foundation is the type of foundation that streaks with a brush and it's really difficult to get a smooth, even finish. So it kind of depends on what I want from my makeup, what my makeup or how my makeup responds to being applied by a brush or a sponge, and how my skin is doing on the day. Now, usually I make it work. Like whatever the go is with the skin or the makeup or whatever, I make it work. But this guy has kind of taken it to an extra level. So if I want the finish of a brush, so full coverage quite quickly without building up layers and using less product, I will go with this guy, especially if the foundation streaks with a brush. So I've got some full coverage foundations. You put them on, they're streaky. They're a pain in the ass. It's hard to blend out with a brush. It doesn't matter what type of brush you use, it's a pain in the ass. You've always got to go over it with a sponge anyway, which defeats the purpose because it lifts product. And then you've got to put on more to get that full coverage back. Not with this guy. This guy is sort of like a hybrid between full coverage brush application and the smoothness of a sponge application. So this isn't replacing brushes for me. It's not replacing my like Holy Grail Ella sponge or other makeup sponges that I really enjoy. This just has a new place. It's opened up a new place in my application routine that I didn't know that I was missing out on something. Turns out I am, and I really, really like it. So when I'm going for like a fuller coverage and I want to get there quickly and not use too much product, but it's not a brush day because the skin says no or the foundation says no, this dude. Another sponge that I'm going to talk about, and look, I can't really talk too much about this because I haven't used it enough to develop real feelings, but it did give me some fucking feelings, I can tell you that much. It is the Juno sponge. So this is the microfiber sponge. I had such a bad experience with this straight off the bat that I'm just kind of scared to use it again. I used this on a day where I was having some pretty bad retinol ugly peels, and it puts foundation on really thick, like really thick. This puts foundation on thin, but with a higher cover. This just puts foundation on thick. Or that's my experience with that particular time I used it. So when you've got like peeling skin, and like retinol peeling skin is literally like, it, if a wind blew too like hard in your face, your skin would dust off. You are Melisandre after the Battle of Winterfell or the Long Night fucking floating off in the frozen desert. It's like, that is what retinol ugly peeling is like. And when you are going over your skin with foundation and a sponge like this, it's just like thick foundation, thick skin. It was not a good experience, but I will play with it a little bit more in May, and I'll try to develop some feelings about it. I feel like because I had a bad experience, I have to wait until my skin is like chilled out. I have to try it with different foundations to see how it applies them, and yeah, but that was my first experience with the Juno sponge. So I know a couple of people have asked me, like, what do you think of the Juno sponge? Like, compare it to this, like, which one? At this point, this is my fave, but I do need to use this more. I need a bit of time to use it to, you know, get rid of the bad feelings from the first time, because it was a lot. Okay, a couple of makeup items. I've only got two that I just loved them. I loved them in April. I'll start with this one. It's Anastasia Beverly Hills. Whoa. This is a liquid lipstick in Requiem. So I put this in my monthly makeup basket to try it as a liner, like an eyeliner. And the first time I used it, I was like, fucking hallelujah. This is gorgeous. It's so nice. It went on beautifully opaque, which surprised me because the other liquid lipsticks that I've used as eyeliners, they work and it's good, but they go on a little bit sheer and they have to be built up. This one went on punchy as something that punches. It was totally opaque. It looked gorgeous. It was crisp. Oh, I loved it. The brush that I loved applying it with is the Sigma EO6 winged liner brush. So this little guy is teeny, teeny, tiny and razor sharp. I would say that's another favorite of this month because these two, so good. They're like a little match made in heaven, especially if you have small eyes. Like me. This little brush allows you precision. You don't have to go too big with your wing if you're trying to avoid that, and it picks up just enough product off the wand to apply, and I loved it. It wore really well. The color is beautiful and interesting. I'm so happy. I thought I would have to get rid of this because I didn't think I was going to have a way to use it, but it worked beautifully as an eyeliner. So they stay. My other makeup item is also from Anastasia Beverly Hills. It is the Soft Clam palette. I had this in my Project Pan for the month of April. So if you don't watch my project pan, you're like, why did you just have it in for a month? I rotate out my eyeshadow palettes every month just so I've got something new to use and I'm not just focusing on one palette out of my over 100 eyeshadow palettes. So I had this in my project pan and I fucking loved it. I loved it. I loved it. I loved it. The mattes in this palette made me so happy. My favorite colors in the palette are Dusty Rose and Mulberry. So you've got like a dark berry red and a dusty rose, like a grayish rosy shade. And all of the other mattes I really like, except Noir. I never used it. I won't use it. I could give less than zero fucks about a matte black in a palette, any black in a palette. I don't need it. What I do need is one really good quality black eyeshadow in my collection, which I've already got. I don't need it in a palette. The shimmers, I actually don't really care for the shimmers all that much. I think the colors work with what is in the palette, but I think they are completely overkill. So Glistening, Fairy, and Bronze, like they, you have to have a super special eye to be able to differentiate between the colors on the eyelid. Like, you know, if you're a makeup artist or an artist who works with a lot of color, okay, you are going to notice the nuances of it, but your boyfriend's not, your mum's not, your sister's not, your friends aren't, no one gives a fuck. Like, seriously. They all basically look the same. So I definitely think that that was completely unnecessary. Rose pink is pretty. Sultry is also pretty, but I'm not as excited by those colors because I do have them time and time again. But what excited me about this palette was the mattes and how they just, they were so easy to use and it was just right up my fucking alley with what I liked with mattes at the time. And even at this time, like right now I'm using the Natasha Denona Sunset palette in my project pan and I just don't fucking care about it. I want to use this again. I miss this. I like this. I like this basic bitch palette. These mattes are like basic bitch Hailey mattes and I like that. I want to be a basic bitch every day, basically. My last product is a skincare product and I haven't been using this long, so you're not gonna really get a review out of this or any like really good information. I'm mostly gonna be talking about packaging and the consistency of the product, but I use these videos to keep track of my journey when I'm using these products, especially when I introduce a new one. It's a new retinol. It's from Drunk Elephant. It is the A Passione retinol cream. So in April I finished up my Glyco Age Repair retinol booster, which I love and adore, and I miss it. I really miss it. But I had this one, it was sent in PR, and I thought I'm gonna try it. There are some more that I want to try. I want to try some from The Ordinary and I want to try one from Chola. Paula's Choice. Jesus, Hayley. So I've started using this and okay, it's a 1% retinol. So it's a little bit stronger than the Glyco one. It does work. I've had some retinol peeling from it and that's okay. It doesn't bother me at all. If that's going to bother you, then I don't know, maybe buffer it with another product or build up really, really slow. Like I do the every third night thing because this was stronger than the Glyco one. I did like use it every third night and then eventually build myself up to every second night. And I've just started using it every night. So you will get peeling, or at least I did anyway, but that, like I said, doesn't bother me. What annoys me about this product is the packaging and the consistency of the product. So the packaging is an aluminium tube. And if you have ever experienced these tubes, you mostly see them with like hand creams and stuff. If you squeeze them too much, they will continue to push product out of the tube even after you've taken what you need. Like you can't, These don't refill with air. Look, this is from last night. So when I used it, it's still pushing product out. And I am so, and it's pushing a lot of product. I am so careful with this. Whenever I use this, this is exactly what happens. I take the cap off and I wait to see if product's coming out. And if it's oozing out like this, I literally just let it sit there for sometimes 5 or 10 minutes until it stops oozing. And if that's about a pea size amount, I'll take it and just put the cap back on. If it's not a pea size amount, I'm very like carefully like squeezing it so that I don't take too much out, or don't squeeze too much out, put too much pressure on the packaging. And then I have this race where I scrape it off and I've got to get, like, it's coming out now. I'm not even squeezing the damn tube. It is just, give me an airless pump, all right? So many of Drunk Elephant's other products are in airless pumps. Why can't that one be? And I don't want to waste this. Going on the back of my hand. Look younger. Look younger. So yeah, I'm just, that packaging really, really frustrates me. Another thing that frustrates me, it smells, I don't know what it smells like. It smells a bit like plastic. Yeah, like plastic toys or cheap shoes, rubbery, kind of smells like that. It doesn't bother me, but that's kind of what it smells like to me. Another thing, the consistency. So I'm used to using an oil formula of retinol, and it makes it so easy to apply. You know, one pump, smooth it over your face, even your neck if you want to, and that's it. It feels comfortable, feels hydrating. There's no like trying to tug product into place. It glides. It's an oil. It's great. This being a cream, it's a fairly thin cream. Once you sort of start to work it in, it absorbs really quickly. Like, absorbs/dries really quickly. So I find a pea size amount, I'm often, like if I start at my forehead, by the time I get down to my chin, it's fairly dry. Or if I start from my chin and work my way up, by the time I get to my forehead, there's not much product left. I can never get like the pea size amount to also do my neck, which I would usually do with a glyco one. So that's kind of annoying. And also, you know, I try not to use too much retinol. I don't want to slather my face in it. The consistency of it and the packaging, it doesn't make for a very fun user experience with applying the product. But with how it seems to be working, I'm okay with it. It seems to be doing what retinols usually do to me. So there's that. So that's it for my April Beauty recap. Feel free to leave any comments below regarding anything you saw in this video or your feels about stuff that was prominent in your life in April. I'm going. Hope you enjoyed it. Give it a thumbs up if you did. I'll see you in the next one. Bye.